Hey, this is Lloyd Irvin, a.k.a. the Grappling Renegade, and I want to welcome you to the next episode of the Next World Champion. Now, I understand this. There are people all over the world that say becoming a world champion doesn't matter. Winning gold medals doesn't matter. Thinking about trying to become first place doesn't matter. And I have kids. I have family. I can't train as much as they do. And if that's your deal, that's fine. But understand this. There's people from city to city, from state to state, from continent to continent, people worldwide, globally, that have and are dedicating their lives to their sport, dedicating their lives to become world champions no matter what their sport is. And to them, those are the people that people talk about. Those are people that people talk about in the forums. Those are the people that people want to hear podcasts about and want to see in Gracie magazine. Those are the people that have dedicated their lives to reaching a goal and have attained their goal. And now the mass majority of the population is now talking about them, watching them, looking at them. In this next episode, you're going to see people on my team that have dedicated their lives and are dedicating their lives to accomplish this goal. You're going to see the agony, the defeat. You're going to see victories. You're going to see tears. You're going to see people that are transitioning from this sport all the way into mixed martial arts. You're going to see so much things, so many emotions. It's going to be absolutely amazing. And if you're one of the few percent of the population that has dedicated your lives and you are working to become a world champion, you are working to get gold medals, and you are doing what it takes, don't let anyone stop you. I don't care if you're on my team. I don't care what team you are throughout the world. I support you. I represent you. And if you keep working hard, one day you too can become the next world champion.
Hello.
Hey, Lance, what's going on, big man?
Nothing happened. Just trying to make it in America, sir.
I know. How's the restaurant doing?
We rocking and rolling, man. We rocking and rolling.
Good. So check us out, man. You know, we got the World Championships in about 2 weeks. The guys are grinding. Like I said, people are beat down, sore. I have, you know, I got massage therapists coming in, giving people massages and so forth. I wanted to switch things up a little bit, and I was thinking about bringing the crew down to your restaurant tonight. Can you get us set up in the spot?
Oh, sure, man. I got upstairs. I can put you upstairs in the VIP lounge. It sounds great. I can tell my girls now to start getting everything set up and put together a nice little menu for you guys. I'd love to see all the guys. Let's do it.
Cool. All right. Well, we got practice tonight, and then I'm going to be out around 8:30. So I'll see you around 9 or 9:30. All right?
See you there, buddy.
All right, man. Thanks. I want to introduce you to my Medal Chaser Drilling Center. As you can see, it's roped off by red velvet rope. The mats are camouflaged. My guys are soldiers, my gals are soldiers, and they're all VIPs. Before you heard anyone talking about 10,000 reps in Jiu-Jitsu, 1996, 1997, I've been doing it. You've been seeing it. Like I said, here you got it. 10,000 reps is the goal. The ultimate combat athlete, Medal Chaser, VIP, private drilling center. And this is where we get our drilling done. This is where we make the magic happen.
So how your body feeling now?
I'm doing all right. Staying in shape, getting better. My conditioning getting better though.
How's your back, like?
It's good. It's good. It'll be good on time. I've been letting it rest. I've been stretching at night, doing my yoga, going to see Dr. Rosa. I'll be good though.
I got a call for another MMA fight for you, but
nice.
I told them we're not going to do anything until after the world, so give us a few time to rest and so forth.
Okay.
But tonight, I need you to send a text message to everybody. I want to take everybody to the Carolina Kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a lot of the guys, Lance spends a lot of money. He sponsors a lot of the guys, you know, different things, and he hasn't even met some of them. So
yeah.
One, to give them a little break. Two, so they can meet one of their sponsors, you know. He has a new spot in D.C., so I want to take him down to the Carolina Kitchen tonight.
The new burger joint?
Yeah.
Okay.
So after training tonight, around 8:30, we're going to leave out early. So just let everybody know to bring regular clothes. We're going to go out to eat and hang out.
All right, I'll do that.
All right.
This is the ultimate combat athlete and medal chasing lounge. We have foosball tables, air hockey tables, pool tables, nice couch, TV, Xbox, PlayStation. We watch videos, but most importantly, the medal chasers get to come out and hang out after practice, before practice, just hang out and relax before hard training. You get penalties for faces. Pump faces. I'm ready to quit faces. I don't want to be here faces. Because this drill is made to put those faces on the normal man.
Lloyd brought in his massage therapist in to help me out. Last few days has been really tough on my body. The last couple mornings I've been having 3.5 hour wrestling practices with Coach Greg because it's the grind, you know. We gotta push it to the limit every single day, so.
I'm Dwayne, I'm here working with the athletes doing massage. Massage is just not a spa thing, it's not just a feel good thing, but it's kind of like medicine. Work on his muscles, loosen his neck up, get rid of the aches and pains that he has so that he can work out harder tomorrow. As well as we're gonna rub that lactic acid out of his muscles so he can go hard and become the champion that he is.
And you beat both these bands.
Yeah, man, I got called out by this dude, Peggy Zimmerman.
Peggy, what's his name? Peggy Zimmerman. Pinky Zimmerman.
Yeah, yeah. So I took that fight on 3 days' notice. I beat him, dominated all three rounds.
You cut the 170 twice?
Yeah, I cut the 170 twice in 2 weeks, man. Won both titles. I finished his last dude in 3 minutes. Less than 3 minutes, and I didn't get sub of the night. I was tight at the end of the night. Always getting disrespected, but it is what it is. Got both titles. I'm trying to be like Mike Easton here one day.
Yeah. what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to pry into the mind of Timmy Spriggs. Timmy Spriggs, who got hurt a month before Worlds last year and wasn't able to show out while all his brothers were winning Worlds. World champions.
Well, I got hurt training. It was like a freak accident because DJ pulled guard and Mel pulls guard. And I held myself on his knee and ruptured.
He had a ruptured colon. He almost died in training and finished the day battling Willie, one of our heaviest and best competitors. All right, keep going.
Next day, I wake up in the hospital bed with tubes in me. So about 3 or 4 weeks later, I was on the mats training hard. I got promoted and brown belt, and I've just been training full time ever since. Really no break.
Hold on, what is the goal?
Multiple time black belt world champion.
Exactly. What you need to
see.
Exactly. As soon as you got promoted, you won the Brown Belt Expo. What was the Brown Belt Expo? We had to put in a resume about how good we were, okay? So we had to spoil all our medals. We sent an application about how good we are, and they invite us out to fight everybody. I couldn't go. I got married, okay? I got married. How many matches did you win, Timmy?
9-0.
Who did you beat? It was nothing.
Because being the best brown belt is being the tallest midget. I mean, at the end of the day, it's not black belt. It's like I won the Little League World Series, but I didn't make it in MLB. It's like, it's nice and everything, but it's not the top.
Exactly.
I won't be in the NFL. I won't win the Super Bowl.
Church. All right, you preach it.
Double goal.
I got the boy Irvin wings. Hey. Yeah, I went and I did. Hey. When the Lloyd Irvin team is in the house, it opens back championship is coming up, so you know you can't eat all this meat and fries. But for those who's just training, we got some all kinds of wings to go up here that I made for you guys. Let's get it in. Hey!
It's a total knockout. We make America's number one hamburgers, but also all the champions in the history of martial arts, as well as boxing in the world. Champions like Muhammad Ali, Sugar Ray Leonard, and of course Floyd Mayweather. But on this wall, right here in this restaurant, with the best hamburgers in the world, we have Mr. Lloyd Irvin, a champion of all champions in martial arts, jiu-jitsu, a business champion, as well as a martial arts champion. We feel like he's the only one deserved to be on this wall, right here in TK World Burger. Why? Because it's a total knockout.
Day one, IBJJF World. It's the biggest event in jiu-jitsu. This is our World Series, this is our Super Bowl, this is our finals, this is everything. We worked so hard all year just to get here, but we came here to win. I fight on Saturday, early in the morning, plan on taking two gold medals home. We got Corey, AKA Corey Santana, AKA Corey Skywalker, and Chris Tran, AKA Short Round. So they're gonna set it off. They're gonna win gold. They're gonna close out the division, set the tone for the whole week.
In the 2013 World Championships, Corey and Chris both made it to the World Championship final, and they had to compete against each other. Now they're purple belts.
Match, but he was on top trying to pass the whole time. Corey was dominating his match as well, so they're going on to the next round.
Oh yeah! Chris and Corey through the next round. Tag team champs of the world. They just knocked them down. Knocked them short ways down, one at a time.
Kyle went out, played his game, looking good. First match out the way.
Jamil is one of Team Lloyd Irvin's homegrown secret weapons. A lot of people don't know his name yet, but he's an absolute killer. Corey won the Blue Belt World Championships last year in this division, but this time his season has come to an end.
started. Maokai foot swept the guy in the first 5 seconds, and then he mollywopped him for about another 5 minutes. 17-0. Maokai is on fire. I've never seen him fight this good before. Never. Not even practice. So he's hitting everything perfectly right now. So.
Fourth match, that's been the hump for him, trying to get that goal.
Day one, 2014, IBJJF World Championships. It was a tough day, a lot of close matches. Good news is he took third place. I'm really impressed by how everybody tried their hardest out there and put it all on the line, you know. But you're not always gonna win. You can try, but you know, sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. But as long as you put that effort, you lay it all on the line and do what you've been training to do 110%, not caring what the other guy's trying to do, you can be proud of yourself.
This is Ray Alexander. She's a full-time college student, part-time jiu-jitsu player. She's already a multiple-time BJJ World Champion. Going to the 2014 World Championship, she didn't want to do it. She didn't want to compete, but Master Donnie convinced her. Master Donnie told her that he believes in her. She came out here and she handled her business. Gobi is an absolute monster. He loves the suplex, but he has an amazing guard also. So focused on his world title, he came up short in Abu Dhabi, but right now he's laser focused. Devin's just getting nastier and nastier every year.
Division, we created two world champions this year and a bronze medalist. So the two world champions, Admison and Muhammad, were going to represent the team in the open division. But Admison was injured and he couldn't continue, so Devin DeBruge got the call up. I'm super happy for Devin. He's been traveling everywhere, competing in the open division, in his weight division. He competes at the middleweight division. And like I said, he was so excited he got an opportunity because his dream was double gold, and he only got the bronze in the middleweight division, and he wanted to get this gold in the absolute. Most people will never know what it's like to dedicate your entire life to a dream and see that dream actually come to reality. And when you see these guys cry, these are tears of joy. You have no idea how much work and time they put into this.
Thank you.
Sergeant Charge hasn't won a world title in Gi since Blue Belt. Now she's on fire. Intense. Tim Spriggs versus Mike Carbolito. Carbolito is an absolute monster. We watched film on him, we game plan against him, and it was an absolute 8-minute war.
Down. Tim Spriggs is in the finals. He's about to go against Roberto Travin, the student. He just beat one of our guys, Master Roberto. So Tim's looking to get revenge. He's looking to get his world title, and this is his time to fight.
But they were easy compared to all the training we went through every single day. I drive back and forth from Baltimore to Camp Springs every single day. I stayed at the firehouse. I've made 100% sacrifice. I wanted to be a 3-percenter. I was tired of talking. I just wanted to do it. I came back from the hospital, had my colon ruptured, almost dying. 1 year later, I'm a world champion, brown belt, heavyweight, number one. I told everybody I won the hardest road there. I won all the beasts, and I took them out one by one. Finals, I threw the guy, choked him out, 44 seconds.
Grand Medal du Monde less than 400.
World champs, baby. So my brothers right here. It's my sis, Sarge. We're a family. We did it. Gold medals. I can't believe it, man. Oh my God.
In this next match, Herbert Santos goes against a guy named Sebastian. This guy is disrespectful. This guy sent me a message one time telling me that he can't wait to smash my students again. And I'm like, again? The last time I remember this guy, Sebastian, competing against one of my guys was when he lost to DJ Jackson at the Europeans as a purple belt. And then like on the forums, you said you saw something about what?
Yeah, all the forums were blowing up like, who's Sebastian, who's who, who's Sebastian, who's who? And then Sebastian got on there and was like, I don't know, some black guy. Really dismissive and disrespectful to DJ.
I mean, I don't know who Sebastian is from the next person, but all I know, like I said, he may be a racist for all I know. I'm not sure what the, he's just some black guy comment may be. Then Sebastian goes to Tim Spriggs' page and tells Tim Spriggs he better be ready. Then Sebastian saw y'all in Abu Dhabi. What happened?
Yeah, it's me, Tim, and I just sitting in the stands and we were just watching some matches. He comes up and says, hey, Tim, what's up, man? Nice to meet you. Shakes his hand, says what's up to me and Nyjah. He was like, all right, man, good luck, bro, and walks off. And I was like, is that the guy? Like, is that Sebastian? And Tim was like, yeah. And I was like, all right.
It's a normal, typical bullshit where guys talk shit on the internet and are tough and bark all loud on the internet. When they see, they don't say nothing. Tim really wanted this match in the open division against Sebastian, but he didn't get it. He got on Herbert's side. Tim let Herbert know, and Herbert said he'll take care of it. So you can check out what happened. Well, as you can see, that didn't work out too well for Sebastian. I'm like, listen, we're always training hard. My guys train hard. We win some, we lose some. But if you're gonna talk shit and you're gonna be disrespectful, you goddamn better well step up and handle your business. Our guys, we're always respectful. We don't disrespect any instructor. We don't disrespect any team. We don't disrespect anybody. Although I do not respect Sebastian for his little racist comments, his black guy comments, his disrespectful comments on Tim's page or whatever he said to me. I don't respect him for coming up to the guys trying to shake their hand after talking all that shit. From a purely Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu aspect, I do have respect for him as a competitor because he goes out there and puts it on the line. And when it was all said and done, after Herbert tapped him out and Herbert got his hand raised, Sebastian looked into the crowd. He saw me in the crowd with my film guys. He knew what time it was. He looked up, he gave me a smile, and a head nod. Mercy God. Mercy God.
Cause this is the year of celebration.
I'm so happy for Herbert. I can't even begin to tell you. Came with a dream, couldn't even train. Like I said, if you knew how bad and messed up he was, I believed in him, I trusted him. I told him he needs to go out there and do the best he can, and he went out there and got double gold.
Keep this fire, keep this passion, don't let it abate, okay? All right. Don't let it go away. I'm gonna be entertained today, all right?
Thanks, Kyle.
Master Roberto is a very special person on our team. Like I said, Master Julius brought him up, and we're getting ready to do something very, very special for him.
First of all, I want to say congratulations to me and Master Julius. We've been talking. Like I said, we're super proud. This is one of the moments that we've been talking about for a while, the entire year. Everybody knows, you know, what's been going on and how hard we've been training and so forth, and it all materialized.
Everybody did a great job. Everybody worked hard, and the results show that. So good job, everybody.
All right, like I said, y'all put it on the line. The black belt from Mr. Roberto Tomalo.
crippled right arm. And the all black on this side. Get that now with the two trips for you.
Best friends in my life through jiu-jitsu, you know.
I have to tell you this. Outside of what happened on our team, for me, the best thing that ever happened at the 2014 World Championships was what happened between Edwin from Gracie Baja and Nicholas from Alliance. Before I tell you about this, I'm going to tell you about our Medal Chaser program. The reason I created the Medal Chaser program is to give people an opportunity to reach a goal of becoming a prestigious world champion. I started jiu-jitsu when I was 26 years old. I got my blue belt in 30 days. I got my black belt in 3.5 years. My instructor unfortunately moved back to Brazil only 6 months into my training, and I was forced to open my own school. So I basically taught myself. I never was able to be under a person's system, under a flawless, proven system to reach my goals. And although I've done really well, I never truly reached my full potential. And I always told myself, if I'm ever financially in a situation or ever in a situation to help other people do what I wanted to do and reach a goal, become a BJJ World Champion, and reach their full potential, I would do it. And that's how the Medal Chaser program was created. And like I said, 2014 Medal Chasers did better than we've ever done before. And if you have a goal of becoming a prestigious world champion, I don't care who doesn't support you, I don't care who doesn't believe in you, as long as you believe in yourself and have a system, you can do it. As long as you're at a school that has a proven track record of creating prestigious world champions, you're in a good spot. Now let me tell you this. Now, Edwin versus Nicholas is a 2014. We're going to the world champion. We're going to the absolute division. Nicholas has accomplished, is getting ready to attempt to accomplish what we call the double grand slam. There's only one person in the entire world ever at the purple belt level to reach this goal of becoming, winning the double grand slam, and they were on our team. And so I've been paying attention, I've been watching. So that's winning your weight division and the open division at the Pan American Championships, the European Championships, the Brazilian Nationals, and the World Championships. And here we go. One match away for him to accomplish the double grand slam. He's fighting Edwin from Gracie Baja, and never in the history of the Purple Belt Open has a lightweight ever won. So everyone's on their feet, and they know Edwin does triangles. They go out and shake hands. They step back, and next thing you know, Edwin throws a lightning fast, probably one of the fastest triangles he's ever done in his entire life. And everyone knows he does it. And he locked it up. And everyone was on their feet. I was on my feet. People were looking. And Nicholas tapped. The crowd went off. The energy in the room was just absolutely amazing. Like I said. And Nicholas is going to be an absolute beast. He's already an absolute beast. Everyone's a beast. They're going to go on, brown belt and black belt. And you're going to hear their names. But like I said, it was an amazing, amazing opportunity to witness that live. And like I said, no matter what your goals are, if you want to become a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu World Champion,
and you're with a good team, and you have a system, and you believe in yourself, you're not gonna let anyone deter you, maybe you can become the next world champion.